Good evening, friends, and welcome to this book discussion forum. So as all of you all would have seen on the invitation, we'll be focusing on the book Sense and Solidarity by Jean Dreje. So before moving in to the book discussion, let's clear some of the technicalities and some of the modalities that will be dealing with this book discussion forum. So in, as you all know, we'll be focusing on the book Sense and Solidarity, also called the Jhola Economics for Everyone. Why is it called the Jhola Economics? All that and more will be in the book as well as in the introduction. You get a small gist of it. So what is this book discussion forum all about? So first and foremost, it is basically a discussion on the entire book, but chapter by chapter. So each month we'll be meeting together online or when time permits together, and then we'll be having a discussion on a particular chapter of a book. Okay, and the book is titled Sense and Solidarity. Now the participants share their opinions and thoughts on that particular chapter that has been selected. For example, if chapter one has been selected, then there'll be one person who will be appointed who will present the chapter. And then the remaining participants will then give in their views, or if anything was missed out by the one who was presenting, they will add in their thoughts. And in this way, towards the end of the session, we will have a holistic idea of that particular chapter. So basically, what is the concept of the book discussion forum? So the book discussion forum is a platform where participants are invited to join in a discussion on a particular selected book and share their thoughts on the selected chapter. So as I explained earlier, it depends on the book that we select. So for this year, it's going to be Sense and Solidarity, and we'll be going chapter by chapter. Now, why participate in a book discussion forum? Okay, you all may say there are other forums that may be there, but why a book discussion forum? So first and foremost, it helps us to enrich our enjoyment of reading literature. It also provides an opportunity to articulate and share our impressions on that particular chapter of the book, because each one of us may be touched by something different in a particular chapter. And when another person shares, I may be enlightened about something that may have not struck me. And in this way, towards the end, there is plenty which we can give and plenty that we can take as we go back. It also gives us an opportunity to hear other people's opinion, because as we know, we as humans tend to think differently, and therefore listening to the opinions of others, listening to their thought patterns also is very helpful. It also can help to strengthen the role of cultural institutions, and most importantly, it can help to build community by providing forums for individuals to discuss ideas and interests and also share their experiences. Apart from that, it also would enable us to strengthen ties with each other. And thus, through this forum, we can also foster a new kind of friendship with regards to having at least something in common, that is the love for reading and the love for sharing our thoughts on what we have read. Apart from this, it is also for everyone to feel part of a community of interests. So as you can see, those who would be joining this forum would be those who would be interested in reading and those who would be interested in learning something new about a new particular book. So the participants for the book discussion forum, it is open for all who are interested and who will be part of the forum on a regular basis. So for this forum, we envisage a particular number who will meet regularly every month and discuss chapter by chapter. So what are the aims? One of the aims is basically to create and to develop the love for reading that we all have. It's also a forum to facilitate a forum on a given chapter and thus enabling participants to share the chapter synopsis already shared. And in this way, we can see that by listening to others, we too can gain a lot, and this could help us in various ways in our lives. Apart from that, it also would promote among those participating the desire and interest in discussion of themes based on various chapters. Once you read the book, you will of course know there are various themes and chapters present in the book. And the way the author has put it is really interesting and marvelous. So once we go through everything, it would also give us a new perspective as to how we look at life, and most importantly, as how we look at the current situation in our country and the dynamics. So an hour once a month will be dedicated to one particular chapter. So beforehand, participants will be required to read the chapter and attend the book discussion forum. Then one of the selected participant, whoever is appointed on that particular day, he will give a brief synopsis of the chapter. This will be followed by those participating who will then add whatever the presenter has missed in his synopsis. And thus, by filling the gaps, we can then relish the true flavor of the themes presented in the book, Sense and Solidarity. And in this way, each participant will get an opportunity in presenting the chapter. So membership, this is a paid forum, and the annual registration fee would be rupees 500. Apart from this, we will also be providing you a hard copy of the book. So having said this, let us directly have a look at the book. Before we begin, let us know something about the author, Jean Drech. So he's a Belgian-born Indian development economist, and he played a very important role in the economic policy making in his country. Apart from that, he studied mathematical economics at the University of Essex and completed his PhD in economics at the Indian Statistical Institute in New Delhi. Now, Jean Drech also taught at the London School of Economics. He holds an honorary professorship at the Delhi School of Economics. And his work in India basically includes on issues like hunger, famine, gender inequality, child health and education, and the NREGA. Currently, he's an honorary professor at the Delhi School of Economics and also a visiting professor at the Department of Economics in the Ranchi University. So this is the bio of Jean Drech. Now, when it comes to sense and solidarity, here are the opinions what others have had after reading the book. For example, Maitresh Ghatak of NDTV says, "It is this combination of passion and humor, of sincerity and argumentativeness that makes Jean Drech's book such a compelling read." He says, "You may not always agree with the happy warrior, but you have to engage with him. Besides, he is good company." Ashwini Deshpande from the Indian Express had this to say, "Beautifully produced with a catchy and moving introduction. This collection is a pleasure to read. Drech writes elegantly and passionately, shorn of rhetoric, arguing that we see India from the lens of the marginalized." And Vivek Kaul also mentions that Drech writes lucidly with a lot of passion on issues that really impact India. So in other words, we can see that this book basically contains certain themes which in a way can enlighten us, which in a way can also put us and make us think in a way of doing something for the nation. So in a nutshell, let's take a look at what the book basically deals about. So it is said that in the last 20 years, there have been a number of intense public debates on social policy in India. At the same time, there have also been some major initiatives such as the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, as well as resilient inertia in some fields. Now, this book brings together some of John Drudge's contributions to these debates, along with other short essays on social development. Apart from this, it also covers topics of critical social policies from education and health to poverty, nutrition, childcare, corruption, employment, and social security. There are also less predictable topics such as the caste system, corporate power, nuclear disarmament, the Gujarat model, the Kashmir conflict, and universal basic income. Now, the book basically aims at enlarging the boundaries of social development towards a broad concern with the sort of society that we want to create. The concluding essay on public spiritedness and solidarity argues that cultivation of enlightened social norms is an integral part of development. In this way, we see that Jolawala has become a disparaging term for activists in Indian business media. And this book affirms the learning value of collective action combined with sound economic analysis. In a way, in his detailed introduction, the author argues for an approach to development economics where research and action are complementary and interconnected. And in this way, we see that as we proceed towards the introduction, which we will be dealing with today, has plenty of themes which also enlighten us on certain thoughts of the author himself. Now, let's take a look at some of the chapters in the book. The first chapter is on drought and hunger. The second, poverty. The third chapter is titled School Meals. The fourth is titled Healthcare. The fifth is titled Child Development and Elementary Education. Sixth, Employment Guarantee. Seventh, Food Security and Employment Guarantee System. Eighth, Corporate Power and Technocracy. Ninth, War and Peace. 10th, Top Up. So these are the chapters which we will be dealing one by one every month. Now, in the introduction, we see that the author explains the motivation of the book and he puts the essay into perspective. Now, after brief reflections inspired by the daily sight of Ranchi's Koilawalas or coal guys, Drudge discusses the basic principles of research for action. He broadly understands all this as research aimed at practical change through democratic process. Among other methodological issues, he argues that experience and evidence are complementary forms of learning. Similarly, he says that economists and activists, known in India as Jolawalas, have much to learn from each other. Now, the reference to Jolawala economics in the title of the book affirms the learning value of collective action combined with sound economic analysis. And as we move deeper into the introduction, we basically see that John Drudge opens the introduction speaking of men moving with more than 200 kgs of smuggled gold. And this happens at daybreak. And he usually observes this from his office in Ranchi. Apart from that, he also mentions that these men have to walk for miles before daybreak in order to secure a proper livelihood. And in this way, he says that even though there have been some changes in the coal guys, now he compares this experience from the book of P. Sainath's, that is Everybody Loves a Good Drought. And he says that from 1996 till now, there have been some changes in the coal guys. For example, they may have better footwear or their children may be going to school. But he says that the nature of the predicament remains the same. In a way, he says that it is not very much different from slavery, except their fact is driven by economic necessity instead of physical coercion. He then tries to analyze and see how did they end up in that situation. In a way, he says, it is all a matter of chance or situation. If they had different circumstances, they could have been great people. But he says that perhaps some of them drank or others gambled away their land and as a result of it ended up in this particular situation. Some, he says, may have been born in poor families or in the wrong caste, or some may have suffered from undernutrition in their childhood. Some may not have got a chance to study. So he says that different circumstances could have played a part in why these people have ended up in this situation. And he says, if these people were in different circumstances, they could have been great people. They could have been geologists, engineers, or even hockey players. And then he says that they didn't have the chance. They are in this situation because they were not given an opportunity or a chance at something. If given, they would have probably made use of the opportunity. He then goes to say that in India, the privileged tend to nurture the illusion that they deserve what they have. And he says that there are some rich people who work hard for their living, but he says so do the Koilawalas, construction workers, and the domestic helpers. And he says that some basis of privilege is based on personal merit. That means people tend to work hard for what they achieve. But he says for many, it is because of the things that they have inherited. For example, aptitude, health, social connections, etc. In a way, he says that even our education reflects inherited circumstances. And mostly it is the efforts of our parents and teachers far more than our own. In this way, he says that the privileged have a responsibility of others. And if this is followed, he says it would be a sensible principle of a good society. He then moves on to the first theme in this introduction, and that is social development. And he says that social development could be reduced to many specified topics, but he says that these specified topics are featured in many articles, many journals, etc. And as a result of it, they are reduced to specific matters on which quantitative indicators happen to be available. For example, child health, elementary education, and gender inequality. He says, no doubt that these matters are important and figure prominently in essays, but there is a great more deal to social development. That is what we can do to create a good society. He also speaks that abolition of violence and other such activities are an important part of social development. He says that the spread of civic sense and public spiritedness can be of great help in preventing corruption, crime, exploitation, and environmental vandalism, among other social activities. And basically, he says that for everything, education is the key, because if the people are educated, first and foremost, they would be aware of the things happening around them. It would prevent them from being cheated. And as a result of it, it would also prevent them from taking any untoward action in their fight for justice. He next speaks on research and action. And here he tends to be a bit more academic in his approach. We see that he speaks of an action-oriented research or a research for action. And in this way, he speaks about the complementarity of research and action. That is, whatever research is done, it should lead us to action, and it should help benefit those who really need the help. And then he basically gives around 7 points on action-oriented research. And first he says that it is that action-oriented research is not a standalone activity. Rather, he says it is part of a larger effort to achieve practical change through democratic action. And in a way, he sees that action based on democratic means and institutions, such as public debate, the media, the courts, the electoral process, among others, can also contribute in a certain way to this action-oriented research. He says that we all, through this action-oriented research, can contribute to more effective action. He then says that the research must also be presented in a clear, friendly manner to the reader. And in this way, we see that he tends to say that in the academic research, there is a tendency to sort of complicate things and to present things in a complicated manner. But here he says that we need to keep things simple, because he says, though complicating matters on certain occasions can be quite rewarding, which basically applies to economics in particular, but he says that when it comes to such kind of social action oriented research, we need to be simple in what we do. Third, he says that action oriented research also resists the common tendency to think of the government as the main agent of change. He basically says that in development economics, it is customary to end a research paper with a few comments on its policy implications. And he says that this typically reflects an attempt to give the research a practical twist based on the assumption that the government policy is the prime mover. But apart from that, though he acknowledges that public policy is important, he also says that research for action addresses itself to the public at large and not just to the government. He then says that this action-oriented research also disputes the conventional view of action and research as antagonistic activities, and it even sees complementarities between the two. He says the basis of the conventional view, influential in academic circles, is that involvement in action detracts from objectivity. He also says that research for action makes special demands on ethical standards. And in this way, he says that when it comes to ethical lapses in academic papers, he says in such situations, it may or may not have serious consequences. For example, the lapses that he speaks about in academic papers include plagiarism, opportunism, fudging, selective reports of results, etc. But he says that when a research is linked to one way or another to the real life of a person, to the difficulties in which the people are living, especially action-oriented research, the ethical implications are much more higher. And in this situation, he says, it becomes difficult to stay aloof from these ethical lapses. And therefore, one should be very careful in dealing with this. He also says that one needs to avoid obligations to funding agencies and institutions, because in some way or the other, these funding agencies tend to stifle freedom. So his basic policy is that one can keep a distance from such funding agencies that restrict our freedom by basically operating in a low-key, low-cost working style. He then also says that pursuit of knowledge is a collective endeavor. And thus, he says that researchers, whether they are action-oriented or not, can turn dangerous when they think of themselves as experts who are competent to design public policies on their own. And therefore, he says, research for action is a simple idea, and there is no need to basically make a big deal about it. But whatever is important is that we keep in mind what we want to achieve and how we need to do that. Next, topic is very interesting. It's titled Hard Work, No Pay. In a way, he basically refers to the people, basically the domestic wage workers who tend to work hard but receive very less pay. And here he speaks about the student volunteer campaigns that were organized by him in collaboration with an associate professor at the Indian Institute of Technology in Delhi. And here this was done during the summer holidays. So initially they circulated an appeal called Hard Work and Low Pay, but then they dropped remuneration because earlier the volunteers were given some remuneration for their services. But the following year, they dropped the remuneration and called it Hard Work, No Pay. And here you see that he notices that when these people were working, you know, they began to work with more passion, because what really came out was that they were working for the cause and not for the money. And he says that was important. He also says that it was the first time experience for many. There were many for the first time who were probably spending their days in a village, working in the field, or also spending nights in cow sheds and other places that may not have been comfortable. And even though he says that for some, it may have just been that experience of one time, but the change in their perspective or vision or their change in looking at reality would definitely have changed. He says, even though there were different motives among the volunteers, some basically came to add another activity on their CV. Some came because their boyfriends or girlfriends were going along. Whereas some also may have come hoping to taste the local rice beer. And he says, among the various motives, he says, there was at least something that these volunteers took with them. And that is a different outlook towards life. Next theme that he deals with is evidence, experience, and enlightenment. Now he says, there is another reason why involvement in action and participation in surveys are valuable activities for a research. Because he says that research and experience can be thought as two complementary ways of enhancing our understanding of these issues. He speaks of the buzzword of today, that is the evidence-based policy, or also called as randomized controlled trials. And basically he says that even though these are very useful in order to make sure that the funds are not misused, etc., he says they can be useful source of insights, but he says if we restrict ourselves to these RCTs or even to statistical analysis as the evidential basis of public policy, we would not get too far. In a way, he says, he then speaks about public policy and democratic practice. And in this way, he basically speaks, gives the example of the NREGA payments. Now, when these payments are given, he says, is it right that the payment should be given from banks, or should the payment be given from post offices? Now, he says that each one of us may have some kind of view, some kind of prejudice against one system or the other. For example, he says that one may say that the post offices tend to be closer to the people, and thus the people can access them much more easily and also get their payments. But then he says, what about corruption in them? And in this way, he says that we can't wait for rigorous evidence every time. If we want to wait for particular evidence to prove something and then move forward, he says it will take an eternity. And therefore, he says that in a way, we need to proceed in doing certain things. As he says, that public policy is best seen as the outcome of a democratic policy. Next, he speaks about experience and values. And in this way, he sees that aside from being a valid form of evidence, he says experience can also be useful in helping us to clarify our values. And he says this is important since economic policy and public action necessarily involve value judgment about goals and priorities. In a way, he also mentions, he gives the example of the social security pension, which he basically says that for some people is something that they look forward to. But at the same time, he says that the government's failure has been that they were not able to raise the old age pensions from rupees 200 per month for the last 12 years. Now, he says that for these people who depend on this social security pension, it really helps them in their own way to be independent and also to give them some amount of small joy in their life. Thus, he says, lived experience can help us put statistical data in perspective and also form a more enlightened view on the priorities of social policy. He says, analysis is useful, but spending time is more valuable. And he says that even when you're doing your analysis or research, even if you spend some time with the people, talking with them, knowing about their struggles, it would make a difference in their life. And at the same time, it would also be much more enlightening for you as well. And finally, the term which is most awaited, I guess, because when we look at the cover of the book, Jholawala Economics, when I saw the cover of the book, I was eager to know what is Jholawala Economics. And in the introduction itself, the author, Jean Drej, gives us a glimpse of what he means by Jholawala Economics. So he says that there is no such thing as Jholawala Economics, but he says that it is just an expression. Now, in a way, he says Jholawala is a term of abuse that is basically used by some of the business media propaganda. Now, some of us may be aware of the term Jhola. Jhola basically refers to a cheap sling bag. And in a way, we see that when activists go from village to village, they basically tend to carry along this cheap sling bag, or a sling bag, in other words, as they go along. And therefore, business media propaganda has made this term as a disparaging reference to the activists. Now, the author says that the work of Jholawala economists and those who work in these villages, going from one village to another, it needs to be appreciated because it is they who work at the grassroots levels and they help in basically formulating certain policies. In a way, he also says that some of these economists may basically think of these Jholawala economists or these activists as something very low. But at the same time, these Jholawalas also tend to think of economists as those only doing research and not getting any practical results as such. Apart from that, these Jholawalas also tend to keep track of details. Now, he also makes reference to Jholawala economics. In a way, he says that it affirms the validity of research action in economics. It is an invitation for mutual learning between economists and the activists, because in a way, it is the economists who have a lot of data at their hand, but it is these activists who know the real situation. And thus, he says that if we can promote a mutual learning between these two, then there will be a sharing of information, sharing of facts and data, which can then help solve the issues in a much more quicker manner. And with this, I finish my presentation of the economic of the introduction of this book. Thank you. So in this way, we will be having a synopsis of each chapter. Now, the next session on the first chapter will be on the 28th of this month, 28th of September. So if y'all are interested, y'all could send us an email at snrioff@gmail.com. I repeat once again, snrioff@gmail.com. And then we will communicate to you the other modalities of the program. Now, May I ask Robin Seelan, the director, to share a few thoughts of his and if he has anything else to add? Over to you.
Thank you, Lindsay, for the wonderful introduction of the entire program. Could I ask everyone to be just switch on your video for a photo session, because we would like to take a photograph of all of you and put a smile on your face as well. Even adjusting his hair, yes. That's very nice. John Wimmel, Petros, George,
Petros, George, okay. All right.
Okay. Would you like to come to the video, please?
Yeah, sure.
John Wimmel, yeah. Thank you. So let's
take
a quick photograph of everyone. Sabio, you are too serious. Smile. Yeah. Friends, once again, thank each of you for being here. This is just an introductory program. I'm sure some of you missed the introductory part that Lindsay offered. Basically, a discussion, book discussion forum is not meant for a wide group. It's meant for a smaller group. And we would like to have as much as possible offline, because we would like to have a face-to-face encounter. But when that is not possible, we'll also have the online mode for those who would like to have, chiefly regarding the modalities, you know, how we will do. When a chapter is announced, we will expect, first of all, we'll expect a commitment, in the sense you say you commit yourself to read till the book is over. One book forum, one book discussion forum will one for one book. So once that is over, then you can say, okay, I will not come anymore. Because once you commit, then we will not be allowing more people inside. We will not allow. We will have only a small group and then continue with that group. That is how it's some you people use the term reading group. Some use the word book discussion forum. So we have chosen the word book discussion forum for our center. Okay, if there are no more questions, we would not like to waste your time. And so we would like to thank you so much for this wonderful evening. And we are really happy that 13 of us were here. And that gives us a great feeling of consolation that people are still interested in reading. And I'm looking forward to that starting of the book discussion. So thank you so much. I think the rest of us all know each other well, not well. We know each other, at least by name, and then we will continue to meet. Once again, thank you, Lindsay, for coordinating this entire venture, and hats off to you. Over to Lindsay.
Yeah. So thank you, Robin, for those kind words and also for the initiative. And of course, this has been one of his ideas, which we have today been able to put it into reality. So I thank all of you for joining us. And I look forward to having you participating with us and journeying together as we complete this book, Sense and Solidarity. Thank you and have a good evening.